You are listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year from the Visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations, available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins, be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God, through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 154, and today we continue reading from volume 3, from the section pertaining to the preaching and miracles of Jesus. Today we read number 5, Jesus leaves Mageddo, cure of a leper. 5. As the feast of the new moon was beginning, Jesus took the return route from Mageddo to Capernaum. He was accompanied by about 24 of his disciples, the four false disciples of John and some of the publicans of Mageddo who wanted to be baptized in Capernaum. They journeyed along slowly, sometimes pausing to stand or sit in the charming spots through which they passed, for Jesus taught the whole time. The way led from Mageddo northward and off to the northwest side of Tabor. Jesus' teaching was a preparation for the definitive calling and the sending of the apostles, which was soon to take place. He earnestly exhorted them to lay aside all worldly cares and to abandon their possessions. His words were so touching and affectionate. Once he snapped off a flower that was growing by the wayside and said, "These have no cares. Look at their beautiful colors, their delicate little stamens. Was Solomon the wise in all his magnificence more beautifully clothed than they?" Jesus often made use of this similitude. He continued his instruction in a series of parables, so striking that each of the apostles could recognize the one intended for himself. He spoke also of his kingdom, telling them that they should not be so eager after high employments therein, should not picture it to themselves as something earthly. Jesus said this because John's four disciples, who were secret partisans of the Herodians, were especially interested in this part of his discourse. He warned the disciples of what people they should, for the future, beware, and described the Herodians in terms so exact that no one could fail to recognize them. Among other things, he said that they should beware of certain people in sheep's skin and long leathern straps. Beware, he said, of the profane in sheepskins and long girdles. By these words, Jesus signified the lurking Herodian disciples of John, who in imitation of John's true followers wore a kind of sheepskin stole around the neck and crossed on the breast. They might know them, he said, by this, that they could not look one straight in the face. Or again, if they, the disciples of Jesus, their hearts overflowing with joy and ardor, should impart something of their feelings to one of these false zealots in sheepskins and girdles, they might recognize him for what he was in reality by the agitation of his heart. It would turn this way and that way like a restless animal. Jesus named a beetle which, when confined, runs round and round, seeking some hole by which to escape. Once he bent back a thorn bush, saying, "Look, and see whether you can find any fruit here or not." Some of the disciples had the simplicity to look into the bush. But Jesus said, "Do men seek figs upon thistles and grapes upon thorns?" Toward evening, they arrived at a row of houses, 20 in number, with a school on the northwestern side of the foot of Thabor. The place lay from 1.5 to 2 hours eastward from Nazareth, and 1.5 hour from the city of Thabor. The people here were a good-natured set. They had known Jesus in his early years when he used to wander around Nazareth with his young friends. They were, for the most part, shepherds. While guarding their flocks, they busied themselves in gathering cotton, which, as soon as they spied Jesus coming, They packed up in their sacks and carried to their homes, after which they hurried forth to meet him. I saw them with their rough fur caps in their hands, but in the school their heads were covered. They received Jesus at the spring, washed his feet and those of the disciples, and offered them some refreshment. There was no synagogue in the place, only a school with its resident teacher. Jesus went to it and taught in parables. This little village belonged to a distinguished man who lived with his wife in a large house at some distance. This man had fallen into sin and was now afflicted with leprosy. Consequently, he lived apart from his wife. She occupied the upper stories of the house while he lodged in one of the side buildings. In order to escape the grievous alternative of entire separation from his fellow men, he had not made known his malady. His case was not, however, so secret that many were not aware of its existence, but they connived at it. It was well known in the little village, and although the ordinary route ran past his dwelling, the people always managed to take another way. They informed the disciples of the circumstance. The poor leper had, for a long time, sincerely bewailed his transgressions and longed for the coming of Jesus. And now he called a little boy of about 8 years his slave, who supplied him with necessaries, and said to him, "Go to Jesus of Nazareth and watch your chance. When you see him at some distance from his disciples or walking apart from them, cast yourself at his feet and say, 'Rabbi, my master is sick.' He thinks that thou canst help him by merely passing before our house, a way that all others shun. He humbly beseeches thee to have compassion on his misery and to walk along the street, for he is certain of being cured." The boy went to see Jesus and very cleverly executed the commission. Jesus replied, "Tell your master that I shall go to him in the morning." And he took the boy by one hand, laying the other on his head with words of praise. This meeting took place as Jesus was leaving the school to go to the inn. Jesus knew that the boy was coming and had designedly remained a little behind the disciples. The boy wore a yellow tunic. Anne's property lay on a height to the west of Nazareth. It was distant about an hour and was between the valley of Nazareth and that of Zebulun. A narrow vale planted with trees ran from it to Nazareth, and by it Anne could go to Mary's house without traversing the city. Next morning at early dawn, Jesus left the inn with the disciples. When he turned into the street that ran past the leper's dwelling, they told him that he ought not to go that way. But he went on and commanded them to follow. They did so, but timidly and apprehensively, for they feared being reported at Capernaum. John's disciples did not go with him by this way. The boy who was on the watch notified his master of Jesus' approach. The sick man came down by a path leading to the street, paused at some distance, and cried out, "Lord, do not come nearer to me. If thou dost merely will me to be healed, I shall be saved." The disciples remained standing at a distance. Jesus replied, "I will it," went up to the man, touched him, and spoke to him as he lay prostrate on his face at his feet. He was clean. His leprosy had fallen off. He related to Jesus all the circumstances of his case and received for reply that he should return to his wife, and by degrees appear again among the people. Jesus admonished him of his sins, commanded him to receive the penance of baptism, and enjoined upon him a certain alms. He then went back to his disciples and spoke to them of the cure just wrought. He told them that whoever had faith and possessed a pure heart might with impunity touch even the leprous. When the cured man had bathed and dressed, he went to his wife and told her of the miracle just effected in him by Jesus. Some spiteful people of the place sent news of the affair to the priests and Pharisees of the city of Thabor, who immediately saw fit to institute a commission of investigation. They surprised the man by submitting him to a close examination as to whether he was really cured or not, and sharply called him to account for keeping his malady secret. They now made a great noise over the affair, which, though publicly known, they had long tolerated. Jesus journeyed quickly with the disciples, all the remainder of the day, pausing only now and again to rest a few moments and take some refreshment. He taught all along the way about the forsaking of the temporal goods and in parables instructed them upon the kingdom of God. He told them that it was impossible to make all these things clear to them, just then, but a time would come when they would comprehend all. He spoke of giving up earthly care of food and raiment. They would soon see a hungry multitude with provisions far from sufficient for their wants. They, the disciples, would say to him, "Whence shall we get bread?" And a superabundance should be given unto them. They had to build houses and build them securely. Jesus said this in such a way as to imitate that it was by sacrifice and personal exertion that these houses, namely employments and charges in his kingdom, were to be obtained. The disciples, however, understood him in a worldly sense. Jesus was very much rejoiced. He gave noisy expression to his satisfaction and said aloud in the hearing of all that he would not shrink labor, that he would do his share of the work. On hearing this, Jesus stood still and said, "We are not yet at the end of our mission. It will not always be as it is now. Ye will not always be well received and entertained. Ye will not always have things in abundance. The time will come when they will persecute you and thrust you out, when ye will have neither shelter nor food nor clothing nor shoes." And he went on to tell them that they should think seriously of those things and hold themselves in readiness to renounce everything. Also, that he had something important to propose to them. He spoke likewise of two kingdoms opposed to each other. No one can serve two masters. Whoever desired to serve in his kingdom must forsake the other. Then passing to the Pharisees and their accomplices, he said something about the masks or disguises that they wore. They taught the dead form of the law and sought to have it observed, but the best part of it, its purport, the charity, forgiveness, and mercy that it inculcates, they wholly neglected. But he, Jesus, taught just the contrary, namely that the rind without the kernel is dead and barren. First comes the essence of the law, and then the law itself. The kernel must increase with the growth of the shell. He gave them also some instructions on prayer. They should, he said, pray in secret and not ostentatiously before others. Many similar things he said on this occasion. When journeying with his disciples, Jesus generally instructed them, thus preparing them to understand better what they would hear in his next public discourse and be able to make it clear to the people. He often repeated the same things, though in different words and order. Among the disciples who accompanied Jesus today, James the Greater and Judas Barsabbas most frequently put questions to him, though Peter did so sometimes. Judas often spoke in a loud voice. Andrew was already well acquainted with the teachings of his master. Thomas was preoccupied as if weighing consequences. John took everything simply and lovingly. The best instructed of the disciples were the most silent, partly through modesty and partly because they were not always willing to show that they did not understand Jesus' words. Thus, journeying through the valleys, they arrived shortly before the beginning of the Sabbath, at the valley east of Magdalum. Here they encountered the pagan Cyrenius of Dabareth and the centurion Achaeus of Giscala, who were going to Capernaum for baptism. When nearing Capernaum, Jesus was instructing the disciples as to how they should exercise themselves in obedience as a preparation for their mission, and especially how they should conduct themselves when he should send them to teach the people. He gave them likewise some general rules for their deportment when in certain company he did this. In a few words, before the departure of the four Herodians, who had journeyed with his little party and sufficiently loud for them to hear, he said, "If on your journeys worldly men join you, whom ye may recognize by their smooth speech and sly questions, who will not be shaken off, who always half agreeing, half good-naturedly contradicting question and discuss various subjects that agitate the heart, then should ye at any cost break away from them. And why? Because ye are still too weak, too simple-hearted. Ye might easily fall into the snares of such lurkers. I do not shun them, for I know them, and I wish them to hear my teaching." This concludes our reading today, and now we reflect on what we have just listened to, what we have just read. At the very beginning of our reading, as Jesus is leaving Mageddo, we hear that he is teaching again. He was teaching the other day as he was walking, but it says that Jesus' teaching was a preparation for the definitive calling and sending of the apostles. It's almost as if he's tilling the ground, right? And then he's going to plant the seed of the call, and then that call is going to have to bloom and flourish. So he's tilling still the ground of the souls of these people who he's going to be calling to follow him so closely as apostles. There was an image here that I think is worthy of maybe just dwelling on. Not much really that I can say about it necessarily, but I think it's more the fruit of our own imaginative prayer. It says that the people here were a good-natured set. They had known Jesus in his early years when he used to wander around Nazareth with his young friends. Is that something you've ever thought of? Have you ever considered the friends of Jesus? The people that Jesus would hang out with on a Sunday, on a Tuesday? What they would do, what adventures they would get into. Probably not something we've ever thought about. The scriptures don't lend itself for our reflection. But here Anne Catherine Emmerich says Jesus had young friends and the people wanted to spend time with him. We hear about this man then who fell into sin and was now afflicted with leprosy. And so we see how that affects his family, that he has to live on one level, the family on the other level. He sends someone so that Jesus would come and just walk by his house because he was certain of being cured. So he has great faith, great confidence that Jesus will do something for him. You think about, how did this man get leprosy? It's contagious, so how was he exposed? Was it, you know, it says here the man had fallen into sin, and so was the leprosy a consequence because of a sinful action? Was it because he had an affair and the person had leprosy, and so now he's living on the top level, his wife on the lower, because they're separated, not only because of his illness, but because of what he had done, and how he would seek reconciliation and forgiveness then, consequently, because of it? We don't know the reason of his leprosy, just that he has it. But again, that great faith. Jesus replied, "Tell your master that I shall go to him in the morning." And he took the boy by one hand, laying the other hand on his head with words of praise. Imagine that little boy the rest of his life, you know, telling the encounter that he had with Jesus. It's a phenomenal little thing, again, to just marvel over. Just like Jesus is for young friends. We hear towards the end of our reading today that Jesus gave them instructions on prayer, that they should pray in secret and not ostentatiously. So Jesus will be continually teaching about prayer, and he'll model that prayer for them as well. They'll ask him, "Teach us how to pray." He's giving teaching on it, but then they'll ask specifically, "How should we pray?" That's when we get the words of the Our Father. And finally, if you're like me, maybe you've realized the repetitive nature of what we've been reading so far in these three volumes that we've made our way through. It says, he often repeated the same things, though in different words and order. Jesus has to repeat it. And by repeating it, it's really an emphasis. This is important. Take note, take heed. And so the repetition, the continual healing of lepers. Our next reading will focus on lepers as well. It's repetitive, but there's still something there for us to receive as we read these things. This brings us to a close of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. Please share this podcast with others. Share it with your family, text it to your friends, send a message out to your prayer group, let them know you're listening, and encourage them to join you so that you can have holy conversations with them about these writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you.